people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. New Delhi hosted the third India-Central Asia dialogue with an aim to further enhance ties between India and these countries that hold a major significance in the evolving geopolitics around the war on Afghanistan. India is looking to expand its cooperation with these energy-rich countries, which are abundant in oil, gas, uranium reserves and other rare metals. In a reach-out gesture, the leaders of the Kazakhstan, Kyrgyz Republic, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan have also been invited as chief guests for India's Republic Day celebrations and parade next month.
Indian outreach to its new arrangements in the Central Asian region has gained momentum, and the third India-Central Asia dialogue reflected that in word and spirit. The vigor and focus between the two sides were underlined by the commitment they expressed vis-a-vis Afghanistan, where the situation has deteriorated to its nadir in the past few months. While all of them agreed to continue providing emergency humanitarian aid to Afghans, the foreign ministers also emphasized the significance of UN Security Council Resolution 2593, which states explicitly that Afghan land must not be used for terrorist sanctuary, training, planning, or funding, and calls for coordinated action against all terrorist organizations. They decided to maintain close cooperation on the Afghan situation. Indian Foreign Minister led the future plan of action, saying that this cooperation will support a peaceful, safe and stable Afghanistan.
Our concerns and objectives in that country are similar: a truly inclusive and representative government, the fight against terrorism and drug trafficking, ensuring unhindered humanitarian assistance and preserving the rights of women, children and minorities. We must find ways of helping the people of Afghanistan.
All five foreign ministers called on PM Modi, who himself had previously visited all Central Asian countries and called it an extended neighborhood, and felicitated them for the upcoming 30th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations. Last year, India had extended a $1 billion line of credit to Central Asian countries for priority development projects in energy, healthcare, connectivity, IT, agriculture, education, etc. In this line, the third dialogue has set the stage for intensifying bilateral relations. Indian External Affairs Minister Dr. S. Jaishankar also met all five of his counterparts bilaterally and highlighted the need to work on four C's: commerce, capacity enhancement, connectivity, and contact.
India is one of the fastest growing economies, where a powerful industrial base has been created and considerable scientific and technical potential has been accumulated. Both advantages create a favorable basis for increasing mutually beneficial cooperation.
India's bilateral and multilateral relations with Central Asia have gained momentum in the recent past. PM Modi's visit to the five Central Asian countries in the early months of his prime ministership and India's permanent membership to the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, that is SCO, in 2017 have paved the way for elevated strategic cooperation between India and Central Asian republics after the launch of Connect Central Asia policy in 2012. Experts are of the view that both sides require each other for their own strategic depth in different regions, and they have been exactly following the trajectory that should have been followed.
Moving on. The United Nations is proposing to pay nearly $6 million for protection in Afghanistan to Taliban-run Interior Ministry personnel. The United States, too, has announced this week that it will be issuing three special licenses to ensure that some international aid could flow to Afghanistan. The decision comes in wake of failing economic situation in the country post-Taliban seizure of power, which has severely affected the lives of common Afghans and has pushed over half of the country towards extreme poverty.
The United States would authorize some international transactions with the Taliban so that the aid to the war-torn country that has stopped nearly entirely could continue. With millions in Afghanistan facing the risk of famine, President Joe Biden has taken steps to let more aid into the country. The Treasury Department announced this week that it was issuing three new licenses, allowing certain officials and NGOs to bypass sanctions and work with Taliban leaders. The decision came a day after the United Nations proposed to pay nearly $6 million for protection in Afghanistan to the Taliban-run interior military personnel. Earlier, the US Secretary of State Antony Blinken had acknowledged the growing hardships in the country and had hinted at taking some action in the direction of improving the situation in Afghanistan.
We've issued multiple now general licenses to make sure that other countries, institutions can feel free to move forward with their assistance and not be concerned about the application or implementation of sanctions against them.
It has been nearly 4.5 months since the Taliban swept to power in Afghanistan, ousting Ashraf Ghani's West-backed government. However, the situation, which many Afghans believed would improve, has only worsened. The feeling of fear has eased out, but not completely, as the Kalashnikov-wielding insurgents, in their ragtag mix of loose traditional clothing and combat jackets, have been replaced by uniformed security forces. But fears of revenge against anyone associated with the former government remain, and there are concerns over what will happen to women and to girls who are still largely excluded from high school education. While this is the reality at ground, Taliban blame American propaganda for tarnishing their image. There are locals who are optimistic under the Taliban too, but are fearful of the economics that will unfold in their rule.
ما از نیاز امنیت یا از نیازی که فساد کم شده از این راضی هستیم. اما از این نیازی که مردم ها پریشان است، اقتصادشان به اصطلاح ضعیف است، در این روزها به مشکلات 25 نرم میگند. مامورین دولت معاش ندارند، دو ماه سه ماه میشه و کسایی که کسب کار بودند و برای اونا کار نیستند، اونا از این لحاظ مشکلات دارند.
In a separate bid to address the crisis, the UN Security Council passed a resolution that exempted donors, aid groups, and financial institutions involved in humanitarian assistance from UN asset freezes on leaders of the Taliban and associated entities. The United Nations says nearly 23 million people, about 55% of the total population, are facing extreme levels of hunger, with nearly 9 million at risk of famine as winter takes hold. Afghanistan's economic crisis accelerated after the Taliban seized power in August as the last US troops withdrew. The United States and other donors cut financial assistance, and more than $9 billion in Afghanistan's hard currency assets were frozen. International community's muted response since then has only made the situation more complex, and only after these UN and the US decisions does it appear that there might be a slight improvement in the situation. But calling it a return of normalcy would be nothing short of an overstatement.
Moving on. The joint endeavors of Indian government and the United Nations have borne fruits, as over 50,000 households have been re-established in the districts of Gorkha and Nuwakot, where thousands were rendered homeless after the massive 2015 earthquake. The Government of India, which has undertaken nearly 200 projects in line of $1 billion support it pledged post-earthquake, has reiterated that its commitments towards the holistic development of its time-tested ally will remain intact in the future too. Have a look.
Dal Bahadur Bishwakarma lost his vision permanently after a wild bull attacked him about a decade ago. And as if this wasn't tragic enough, he had to live without a roof for over half a decade after the devastating 2015 Nepal earthquake, which took away his home too. It is only now, after the combined efforts of the United Nations Development Programme or UNDP and the Government of India, that he has concrete walls around to give him a homely feeling. Dal Bahadur recollects how hard his life has been, which would become even more miserable during monsoons and winters when the rickety shelters were just not enough to resist the perils of weather. Even blood relations abandoned him in the crisis.
Ami yehi dana bathim, yehi dana ma yehi 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 ba mathi dana mathiyo. Bhai ko jagga, tayi bashi rathim. Bhai li beje ani diye na ani na diye bashi ani ya zare.
Dal Bahadur is one of the first groups of families that have been relocated in the Palungtar municipality of Gorkha, which was the epicenter of 7.8 magnitude quake. The reconstruction drive initiated with the Government of India with UNDP's consultation has ended years of the daily struggle for thousands of households in Gorkha and Nuwakot that were most affected by the devastating earthquake.
We have just completed our reconstruction program here in Nepal in collaboration with the Government of India. Their support has been generous. I think it has been transformational for certainly for UNDP as a partner to India. And thanks to the support from India, we have been able to rebuild 27,000 private housing, private houses in the Gorkha region. There's many things that stand out about this program, aside from the physical reconstruction of the 27,000 houses. We have rebuilt houses. We've also built capacities, though, among the men and the women who are the beneficiaries from this program. They have learned themselves through the program, through collaboration, the socio-technical support we provided, they have learned and have had a stake and a say on the reconstruction itself.
The Indian government had committed $1 billion for the reconstruction of Nepal in form of grants and a line of credit. $150 million were allocated for the reconstruction in the housing sector, $100 million as a grant and $50 million in the form of a line of credit. It has helped in the construction of 50,000 houses in the Gorkha and Nuwakot districts of Nepal. The Government of India has appointed UNDP and United Nations Office for Project Services or UNOPS as socio-technical facilitation consultants for Gorkha and Nuwakot district in 2018. New Delhi, a time-tested partner of Nepal, is currently working on over 200 projects in Nepal to provide it with a holistic makeover.
We're very happy that the housing sector, which was a priority sector, has been completed under this reconstruction assistance. We have managed to complete this and marked the completion last month, and we've built 50,000 houses in Gorkha and Nuwakot. With the help of UNDP and UNOPS, we were able to also impart skills and build capacities of the beneficiaries in these districts, which we hope will make it more sustainable in terms of the kind of opportunities that are available for the local population there.
Nepal earthquake of 2015, also called the Gorkha earthquake, struck the region on April 25, 2015. About 9,000 people were killed. Many thousands more were injured, and more than 600,000 structures across different towns were either damaged or completely destroyed. The international community had then pledged coordinated support for its reconstruction. But it is only now with India and the UN working in tandem that those who were hit really hard in 2015 are gradually witnessing a return of normalcy in their lives.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
Amid heightened tensions with the United States and Israel over possible Israeli plans to target Iranian nuclear sites, Iran's Revolutionary Guards fire ballistic and cruise missiles during war games in the Gulf, the state TV reported. Iran says its ballistic missiles have a range of up to 2,000 kilometers and are capable of reaching arch for Israel and US bases in the region. The exercises also included the simultaneous firing of 5 cruise missiles and the launch of armed drones capable of hitting 2 targets each. The 5-day drills concluded on Friday. Tehran has also warned of a crushing response to any move against it by Israel, which opposes efforts by world powers to revive Tehran's 2015 nuclear deal and has long threatened military action if diplomacy fails to prevent it from acquiring a nuclear bomb. Iran says its nuclear ambitions are peaceful. Israel is widely believed to be the only Middle Eastern country with a nuclear arsenal. South Korean small business owners held a rally in central Seoul to protest against tighter curbs ahead of holiday season and called for compensation. About 500 business owners gathered in front of government complex and chanted slogans such as abolish curbs and compensate loss. They also tore copies of business license on stage and said they cannot afford to follow another curfew anymore. A few days back, authorities announced a series of social distancing measures lasting until at least January 2. They include limiting gatherings to no more than 4 people and forcing restaurants, cafes and bars to close by 9 p.m. The measures came just 6 weeks after highly vaccinated South Korea eased many restrictions to try to live with COVID-19. Since then, daily cases and serious infections have hit record highs, adding to strains on the country's medical system. Mitla company in Takamatsu city of Japan is introducing IT to medical institutions by developing perinatal electronic medical record system, Hello Baby program. After research and study, the company developed customized system for Indonesia and complies with all requirements for doctors, clinics and hospitals. Japan International Cooperation Agency is also supporting the expansion of Hello Baby program in Indonesia to solve high mortality rate of pregnant women, lack of cooperation between hospitals due to the traditional storage of medical records and the problem of medical service disparity between urban and remote areas. Online meetings with local staff are regularly scheduled. Feedback is also received from doctors in Indonesia. Yamaha has developed a forest monitoring system using unmanned helicopter. Equipped with cameras and equipment to measure light reflections, helicopters will help to measure the topography as well as tree density, alignment, numbers and trunk diameters. Unmanned helicopter can measure forest ranging from 100 meters high and up to 100 hectares. It takes pictures of forest once in every 2 seconds. The helicopter moves slowly and enables to take pictures of the entire forest. It is very useful to fix all the boundaries, Digital data will use a combination of photographs to visualize the forest, which include the surface of earth and forest, its density as well as height difference. Yamaha is promoting three-dimensional digital forest monitoring system around the world. It will also contribute to activating forestry and the maintenance of green forest environment.
Moving on, the 40-day period of harsh winter has taken the entire Kashmir Valley of India in its grip. Popularly known as Chillai Kalan, this is the time when the temperature drops down to sub-zero and use of traditional items like Firan and Kangri increases in the valley. So let's go a little deep to know more about this shivering cold phase that has also been inspiring the literature and folk culture of Kashmir for years.
The gloomy yet beautiful period of Chillai Kala has knocked the doors of the Kashmir Valley. The water of lakes has started to freeze amid the sub-zero temperature. The mountains are covered by a thick snowpack, plants have frozen, and people are heading towards markets to buy the knee-length cloth, firan, the traditional fire pot, kagri, and dry fruits to protect themselves from the severe cold conditions. Regarded as the most severe part of the winter in Kashmir, this 40-day period begins on December 21st and ends on next year, January 31st. It is then followed by a 20-day Chillai Kurd, a small cold, and a 10-day long Chillai Bachcha, baby cold. While recounting the memories of the past, our famous historian Zarif Ahmed Zarif said that our ancestors started the preparation of this period in advance and it was not like a calamity for us, but we used to celebrate it.
हमारी माएँ बहनें जो हमारी यहाँ औरतें होती थी वो सितंबर के शुरू से ही सब्जियाँ सुखाते थे हमारा हर कोई चीज़ पाँच महीने छः महीने के लिए रिज़र्व होता था हमें ये पहले से ही मालूम होता था हमें कोई अब आने वाला है जिससे हमें मुकाबला करना ज़रूरी होता है तो इस लिहाज से हम तैयार रहते थे हम मिडिल क्लास के लोग अपर क्लास के लोग मिस्किन जो गरीब लोग हुआ करते थे सब इसके मुकाबले में अपने अपने महाज पर बराबर चाक चौबंद रहते थे ये हमारे लिए कोई आफत नहीं थी जब बर्फ़ पड़ती थी यहाँ उसी से हमारी सिंचाई होती थी पानी होता था पीने का नहरों का दरियाओं का पहाड़ यहाँ हमारे होते थे बर्फ़ से वो समझ ले चांदी जैसे वो पकड़ी बांधी होती थी उनको हम मॉडर्न ज़माने में हम तो कदरें बदल गई हैं रिवायात बदल गए हैं तो इस लिहाज से हम ये सेलिब्रेट करते थे
To add some excitement to the bone-chilling weather of Chillai Kala, a number of cultural programs are also organized in the valley, wherein the artists electrify the atmosphere with their energetic performances. Moreover, such events give locals a reason to come out of their houses, as otherwise they find it hard to step outdoors.
हम ये दिखाना चाहते हैं कि हम हर मौसम में काम करते हैं यहाँ का जो आर्टिस्ट है वो अपनी फ़नी सलाहियत जो है उसको लेकर आता है आवाम के सामने और आवाम से जुड़े रहता है ठीक है चले कलान है मुश्किल वक्त है ठंड बहुत ज़्यादा है सब चीज़ें हैं नहीं इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि आर्टिस्ट कश्मीर का या जो न्यू कमर्स वो बैठ गए हैं हम उन आर्टिस्टों में वो अपना जोश जो बरकरार रखना चाहते हैं और अपनी आवाम के साथ जुड़े रहना चाहते हैं पूरा साल
Chillai Kala has also inspired the literature and folk culture of Kashmir for years. It provided a creative impetus to many artists and writers with seemingly mundane subjects of bare trees, frozen rivers and isolated towns and villages.
Chillai Kala is a Persian term which means major cold. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
people have to live in unity?
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.